Slovakia Chronicles, a podcast of information, news and much more of our beloved Slovakia. By Andrea Paolo Mazzucchetti. It's me! Let's start! Hello everyone! Welcome to the 17th episode of the Slovakia Chronicle podcast. Being an immigrant in a foreign country is not easy at all. Moving abroad is a major life event for anyone who is brave enough and lucky enough to take the leap. While being an expat is exciting, fun and eventful, it can also be challenging. There are many difficulties you need to overcome once you decide to move, as fitting as an expat, making friends, the language barrier, the distance from home, the cultural shock, and adjusting to work in a new country. If being foreigner in a normal situation is very tricky, imagine now during the COVID-19 period. By the way, the situation related to the pandemic is very surreal lately. In fact, it looked like that the number of cases is start to increase again in all Europe. But Slovakia is also including more than one country in the list of the safe nations, where it's not required any test once crossed the border. And the most surprising aspect is that, for example, UK and Spain are considered safe, while Portugal is not in the list, but they have less cases in comparison to the other countries. So, maybe not much diplomatic pressure from Slovak consulate in Portugal? Maybe. Anyhow, talking about immigration, Slovakia is not one of the traditional final destinations for migrants. It's a culturally homogeneous country, which was not affected by the dramatic increase of the immigration during the 20th century. Until recently, Slovakia was almost exclusively a country of origin of migrants. In other words, a country whose residents used to migrate abroad for various reasons. It was an accession of the Slovak Republic to the European Union and the Schengen area that caused most significant changes. During the period since 2004, the legal and asylum migration has decreased and the legal migration had increased more than 4 times. Although the increase of the foreign population in Slovakia in the years 2004-2008 was the second highest among the European states, the representation of foreigners in population remained low. Today, the foreigners make up 2.2% of the population, and their number is slowly yet continuously increasing. To talk about immigration in Slovakia, I have contacted Barbara Masova, director of the non-profit organization Human Rights League, that provide legal assistance to foreigners and refugees in our beloved country. So take your time and listen to our conversation about this important initiative. Thank you, Barbara, to be here.
Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you. It's a real pleasure because I love your initiatives. So that's why I decided to invite you. And of course, I'd like to introduce yourself, first of all, and then we can go through some questions.
Okay, I appreciate very much that you've given me this space and opportunity to introduce myself and the organization that I'm representing.
Thank you.
My name is Barbara Mešová and I'm the director of the Human Rights League. Mm-hmm. This is a very small NGO in Slovakia, a non-governmental organization, which is like a civic initiative, civic association created in 2005. Mm-hmm. By lawyers and attorneys in Slovakia. So I was not really there completely at the beginning, but I joined very early, a few months after. Mm-hmm. And as a young lawyer who had this idea that the law should be the instrument of helping others, I found people of the same thinking in the Human Rights League. So that was kind of a thing which attracted me to become part of the Human Rights League. What is interesting about us is that we started with providing legal aid to asylum seekers and refugees coming to Slovakia, thanks to funds of the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees. And from that area, we developed all our expertise on migration. So also on migrants who are coming because of work, study, entrepreneurship, or those who come because of love or relationship or family matters and all kinds of things. Mm-hmm. And we've become also interested in issue of integration, not mm-hmm. just whether what kind of conditions they need to fulfill according to the law mm-hmm. to be able to get and maintain their residence, but also the question of the integration rights. Mm-hmm. How you apply different kinds of rights as a foreigner in Slovakia, not just a foreigner, also in special cases as refugees, because they would have a special position. Mm-hmm. And we've become just specializing on this. So we do not really engage in other areas, although the name Human Rights League sounds quite like it covers a broad rights. In reality, we still have this step to take maybe in future. It's not that we're not thinking about it, but in reality, our portfolio of programs and assistance that we provide mm-hmm. Is concentrated on immigrants of different kinds. Mm-hmm. We are non-profit and we provide our advice or legal aid for free. So mm-hmm. we are dependent on finding our projects, grants, donations from big organizations, small organizations, foundations, from the governments, embassies, mm-hmm. and also from individual donors. That's something that we try to do. What I think is very interesting about Human Rights League is that we do provide legal aid for free mm-hmm. For those who cannot afford it, but we think they are in a situation that they need legal advice. Mm-hmm. Then we also provide it as advice in cases where kind of everybody failed. Well, it often happened to us that we ended up with cases of foreigners who mm-hmm. already went through different kinds of step of advice. Usually police would be rejecting them. And we either really tell them that there's no way for them to really follow what they're trying to apply because the law is too strict. Or we think that the international law mm-hmm. or the human rights law should actually apply to them, and this is of a stronger value than the Slovak law. Mm-hmm. So try to help them fight this, but sometimes it's very lengthy, can be costly, and it takes a lot of energy. So not everybody wants to do that, but we've had several cases like people who would have no citizenship, mm-hmm. people who would be homeless basically, people who would have really difficult cases where it would not be acceptable for authorities according to the strict sense mm-hmm. of the law. But then when you interpret it in the way how the European Convention, for example, interprets mm-hmm. things, or the Court of Human Rights in Strasbourg, we were able to move the discussion, the legal discussion, a little bit. So just to conclude, we are lawyers mm-hmm. and the law and understanding of the law and application of the law is our way of, or our instrument with which we would like to be helping people.
Cool.
Okay. So one way is the legal aid, and the second part of what we do is commenting on legislation, trying to better the policies and mm-hmm. This area of raising awareness about migration, just trying to have a general population knowing better about migration, and also providing information to foreigners who live here.
Perfect. And I want to ask you, these services that you are providing, they are just for Eastern European people or also for European citizens?
Well, this question is arising in Slovakia often, but this is due to that the most of the funding that comes for mm-hmm. organizations which provide services to foreigners is from the European Union, from the Asylum, Migration and Integration Fund, which mm-hmm. defines as its target group third country nationals.
Of course. Mm-hmm.
So what they try to say is that you have to claim that these services are for third country nationals who, of mm-hmm. course, are from a different Well, they do have also less a set of smaller set of rights compared to internationals, but we ourselves as organization do not restrict ourselves to any. Like, we would even help Slovak citizens, we would help EU nationals, whoever comes. The thing is sometimes limited for us that if we how we raise our capacity. Our capacity is of course limited. I said we're small, so sometimes we might not have capacity to provide this kind of direct assistance that we do to everybody, but we try. And when it comes to integration assistance and integration rights, I think it's very interesting to also see how they reflect on EU nationals from other countries who decide to settle and reside in Slovakia.
And regarding your activities, how do you sponsor your activities in the communities? Like, I imagine through some such a network, right?
We do have this small network of cultural mediators, of our former clients, of people who work as interpreters for us. So we do have quite an outreach throughout the years. We've just celebrated our 15 year of existence in April. So we do already have quite a large net of contacts from our past activities. So this is the way how we do it. We also do have a Facebook account, Facebook page, where we do daily basis inform about our activities. We try to also stay active on Instagram. And now lately a little bit Twitter. We were trying to explore also possibility about the LinkedIn, because we've discovered there's this kind of interesting community of people who are working or doing business in Slovakia, which is interesting for us as well. And we try to do regular information about our projects, what we've succeeded in, about we try to bring a little bit of human story, such as some successful cases of our clients that we celebrate a little bit, and also news if there is something new regarding policies, change of policies, and so on. So that's what we do on Facebook, and also we do have webpage, but this is not something that people usually visit without finding maybe information on social media. So we try to be everywhere.
This is the right way, I would say.
Another thing that we have, but this is in cooperation with the cities that are our partners, Bratislava, Trnava, Banská Bystrica, and Košice region. We have a newsletter that we send every month in English to foreigners who signed up on our page, and they receive information about what's new in those cities. Those are usually information about events, cultural events, maybe exhibitions, something interesting that is up next month. But we also try to give them information about maybe most important developments in the local policies that they should check. Like, if there was a change in the, for example, parking scheme, or I don't know, the price for the tickets changed, or some kind of local policies, or there is some donation scheme open, we try to bring these kinds of information also to foreigners who live in the city. I think maybe later we will talk about this, but I would maybe highlight it now. Because the main thing is that foreigners who live in Slovakia, in cities, they are citizens of the cities. So cities should see it as their inhabitants, and services which city provide is not just for the Slovak citizens, but for all kinds of citizens who live in this territory. Because it doesn't matter whether people are Slovaks or from any kind of nationality, they use the public transportation, they use the parking, they send children to schools, and all these kinds of things, or the, or for example, they do produce waste, and waste must be somehow recycled and taken away. All of these functions are fulfilled by the city, the municipality. So this is also something that we do with municipalities, so they can see them as also more of people who are citizens of the city, and they can receive information through this newsletter that we send on monthly basis. So maybe we can share the link under the video.
Definitely,
where people,
yes.
If they wish so, they want to sign up. If they live in Bratislava, Banská Bystrica, Trnava or Košice region, we can also include them in the mailing list for this newsletter.
Definitely, yes. Because something that I remember when I arrived here 4 years ago, I was really missing this type of information. I didn't even know where to find it. Because everything, of course, was in Slovak, and of course, at the beginning, I didn't know anybody, so I arrived here without any contacts. So for a person like me, coming here, maybe now the situation will be different, but still, it's still unclear where to find the right information. So this initiative, for sure, is a perfect one, I would say.
It's good that you're saying that, because this newsletter is about updated information, like news. But what you are saying, like a set of, like we call it a welcoming package, something which we are developing with the cities as well, that they should place on their web pages, because what we've discovered with them, that most of information which is available in English for foreigners on pages of cities is for tourists. Like where to go, where you can see, which is nice, of course, it's good, it's nice service, but it does not really include foreigners who settle, who, right, who need to know how to use transportation, how to find the hospital, what if you have emergency issue and you need to resolve the dentist, things like, information like that. So we've collected that into a welcoming package, and we hope that before the end of the year, we're going to have, with the cities that I named, that we're going to have something like that included on their web pages for foreigners who live, who are citizens of the city.
Definitely, because, for example, even on a stupid information, for example, where to recycle the metals. I don't know, like, really, something that I was experiencing, or like electronic devices. For
yes.
Me, I didn't know, for example, where to go. And here, of course, there is no like this type of recycling here in my like neighborhood. And I don't know who to ask also, no? So you really know the person that is not able to give me this information, or really you are like going in the dark completely. So definitely these activities is really appreciated, at least for my part.
We to fulfill, and maybe we will, like, I think it should be a work in progress, because you cannot really make an exhaustive package of all information, then they also change, so it should be something which is open and open to updates, and to include information which is missing. So it's always good to receive some comments on that also from the community.
Feedback for sure will help
foreigners who live here.
Perfect. And regarding the lockdown that we are just experiencing, what activity you put in place for cover this moment? Because I imagine that, of course, you cannot make any activities like in real person, but maybe you can do something online.
No, in reality, what happened is that there are several NGOs which are active in immigration and integration of foreigners. And it kind of accelerated our cooperation already from the past, because we've been trying to always align some of our initiatives, or even if we wanted to come up with some public call and ask authorities to do something, we usually asked others to support it, so we go together as a coalition of NGOs, so we have more voice. So lockdown kind of paradoxically accelerated this kind of cooperation, because we've even set up a coordination group on Skype, and we were meeting. We even had three different working groups, and we were meeting on a weekly basis, discussing questions of how we provide information to foreigners in English. So, because that was the biggest challenge that we identified from the beginning, it was that information was changing on a daily basis, but it was unfortunately not really available to people in languages, because when we're talking about English, it's actually only one of the languages which mm-hmm. helps foreigners to understand what's going on in Slovakia, because we have a large largest community of foreigners who live in Slovakia is from mm-hmm. Ukraine, the second one from Serbia. So we've included this kind of information on preventive measures and all kinds of measures that the government was adopting. We were not able to do it as often as was needed, but mm-hmm. from our capacity, what we did was that include as attachment to the newsletter that mm-hmm. I already mentioned, we also did something like COVID information, where we in different areas listed information about different measures from healthcare and hygienic perspective to what kind of support you can get as an employee if you become unemployed, or if you are entrepreneur, or if you cannot pay for the rental, if you can ask your landlord mm-hmm. to maybe postpone
mm-hmm.
yeah, rental fee, things like that. So we were trying to bring this information, and we were doing it in English, Slovak, Russian and Serbian language. Mm-hmm. We included those languages in that too, so we get to as many people as possible. But that's a challenge. I think it shows us for the future that this is something that we will need to see how we can do better mm-hmm. in of providing information on regular basis in these languages. And I mm-hmm. think it requires some good community leaders or people who would be from communities helping us also spread this information further on to communities.
Yeah.
So that was one thing which accelerated us, was that we are in a process of establishing a platform of organizations helping with integration of migrants. Mm-hmm. And for us as Human Rights League individually, we, as I said, we help with the law. So what we felt from the beginning as a crucial thing to see how the government and the Ministry of Interior reacts to the situation, to the mm-hmm. lockdown, and to the fact that the Department of the Immigration Police were closed down. You couldn't really do anything there. You mm-hmm. couldn't apply for new residence, or it was unclear how you renew things if you were running out of the validity of the documents. So first what we saw was that they were going a little bit strange way when they were telling to people that well, no problem, if you run out of the document, you have 30 days to leave the country.
Yeah.
As if they didn't understand that people who invested their time, their life into the country, they're part of the country, and yeah. they should find the way. But after discussions, we also showed them the model how they adopted it in Czech Republic. So the Ministry of Interior and the police went in quite a liberal way, adopting the measures, saying that the residencies are valid during the crisis time, and the same with visa, mm-hmm. which is what is actually interesting is that since the definition of the crisis time is very broad in that law, it means okay. it's still on. And it's still on there, and it's like, I think maybe one moment we should just go back to strict rules in a way mm-hmm. how they are applied, because then it becomes confusing, because you can have invalid residence, but it's still valid, but it doesn't really help you if you want to find a job and you show your invalid residence card to an employer. He's like, oh, but you're illegally here, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So it's really difficult to explain it. So I think it's best way, if it's possible, if the papers and the documents actually correspond to the reality and to the legal situation. So we should go back to that if it's possible as soon as possible. We just in June, at the end of the June, we finished a longer project that we have for 2 years. We were collecting and analyzing Slovak immigration and integration policies, and mm-hmm. we've come up with the analysis report and recommendations. Unfortunately, it's in Slovak, but the summary of the report where main recommendations are listed is also available in English, so it can be read by anybody who is interested. Mm-hmm. But I don't want to go into the detail, but why I'm mentioning this is that the most important recommendation, the number one recommendation that we have there, is that Slovakia should finally establish one centralized office, mm-hmm. which will cover migration as such. So that means that it will go from the first moment to the last moment, means from the residency to the citizenship procedure. Mm-hmm. And who can also be resolving all kinds of issues that foreigners have. Kind of like say that there is no master, because at the moment it's only the police. Mm-hmm. They call themselves Bureau for Alien and Border Police, but those are, in our opinion, not necessarily police jobs. We think that this should be a civil procedure, yeah, when it comes, exactly, to residency, and police is really necessary there in terms of controlling whether the rules are observed, mm-hmm. and protecting the border, etc. And maybe expulsion of those who are not following the rules, overstaying without authorization. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, it should be a big office doing analysis, seeing where the gaps on the labor market are, so they could maybe do fast track procedures for those foreigners who we actually need to have in Slovakia, that we need to attract for the healthcare, for senior care, for IT business, etc. Right? So we think that this area lacks a mastermind, somebody would be like taking it as an
interview.
Mm-hmm. Field of expertise, so they could be doing analysis, and based on analysis then they would be proposing the policies and law. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, now it's the police and migration office, but it's migration office, they only deal with the issue of refugees, of asylum seekers. So in reality they would probably just transform into a small department of this kind of big office. So we think that this is something which would be good to do. And what gives us hope in this moment is that the new government came up in April with their governmental declaration of their program. Mm-hmm. And it does not say much on migration, but that one thing that they would like to do, the centralized body for this area, they mentioned there. So we are ready to help them. And
finger crossed. Let's see.
We are ready to offer our expertise, our advice, and that's one of the things that we are also open to, and that's why we want to maintain dialogue with the foreigners community in Slovakia, so we can actually reflect the voice of foreigners to the ministry.
Yeah, yes, exactly. We need this link. That's for the moment we don't have. So for sure this would be very welcome mm-hmm. in our community. And regarding exactly the situation of foreigners in Slovakia, what is the percentage, do you think, that is increasing in the last period?
I just checked, because it's usually the time of the year, the end of July is usually time of the year when they publish the mid-year statistics, and they are already available from this week. So I was checking on that, and actually it looks like, of course it's still increasing, but I think the lockdown and the COVID situation slowed things down a little bit, because when you compare the numbers from mid-year last 2019, it's quite an increase, but when you compare it to the numbers maybe at the end of the year, it's not such an increase, especially the number of people who are employed as foreigners or who are working as foreigners in Slovakia are a little bit decreasing, not significantly, but maybe a few thousand each month, it went down. But there is nothing major. You would have expected that it would be a much more visible drop, but it hasn't. So as of 30th June this year, there was 88,000 foreigners from third countries. living in Slovakia, mm-hmm. and almost 58,000 EU nationals from other countries.
Okay.
So, compared to last year's statistics, it's not a big increase, because at the end of the year we had 143,000 total of foreigners, mm-hmm. and now as half year later it's 145,000.
Okay.
So it's really slowed down.
Yeah.
It increased only in maybe 3,000 people.
Yeah.
But before, we've seen a much bigger acceleration.
Mm-hmm.
What is interesting is that when you look at the different purposes for which the residence is granted to people with a temporary residence, they mm-hmm. have to have one prevailing, or actually one purpose for which they are claiming temporary residence.
Mm-hmm.
So, of course, the mostly popular is employment. What is interesting was that before, at the end of the year, the second largest purpose was foreign Slovaks. But at the moment, it's entrepreneurship.
Of course.
And mm-hmm. we do know that being entrepreneur as a foreigner from third country in Slovakia is quite difficult, because you have to show that you have a lot of money to invest into your business, and if you want to maintain the business, it's also quite strict mm-hmm. in terms of how much income or how much tax income you show. So it's interesting, and what is increasing is number of students who are coming to Slovakia to study.
Okay.
In universities and even secondary school is our experience.
Mm-hmm.
It appears that a lot of Slovaks go to study abroad, and their seats are taken by a lot of people from other countries who come. Yeah, I think a lot of Ukrainians, at least in Eastern Slovakia, we have that experience. It's a mm-hmm. lot of people from Ukraine coming and sending their children to school here.
And so, regarding the initiatives that you are, the projects that you are like presenting, mm-hmm. what is going on in this moment?
Well, we have several different initiatives, but those that I wanted to mention most importantly, because I think that could be most interesting to mm-hmm. listeners, is the one which I already mentioned regarding our analysis and mm-hmm. recommendations. Maybe when I say something like migration policy, it sounds really distant from people, but I can explain a little bit more on what it is and what it mm-hmm. contains next Friday.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to have a roundtable in Bratislava, in Baštova number 5, in the Open Gallery, mm-hmm. under the Open Society Foundation, in the gallery at 4:30 p.m.
Mm-hmm.
Next Friday. We also have an event on our Facebook, which will be promoting more.
Mm-hmm.
And we would like to meet with people just to discuss, because now it's the time to raise voice and maybe try to present the voice to the Ministry of Interior, because the current migration policy, which specifically talks about who can be coming to Slovakia under which conditions, part of it, can be commented on, because the old policy is until year 2020,
mm-hmm.
and now is the time when they will be passing the new one. So I think it would be a good collaboration. Yeah, we've done this last 2 years, that we had several roundtables, which we organized in Bratislava in the past, and we collected already input from the foreigners. We translated it into our analysis, but it's never enough, and it's 2020, and we haven't had a roundtable like that yet this year.
Okay.
So we would like to present this opportunity to foreigners to come and talk about what concerns them, and
mm-hmm.
what the recommendations are. And the second initiative which we have is which I mentioned with the cities,
mm-hmm.
because as I say that we usually come up with this from this background, that integration takes place in the city, in the neighborhood where you live, where you go to school, to bar, to a restaurant, where you take out the trash. This neighborhood, so the city. And we've been trying to involve city municipality, the administration of the cities more into the migration agenda, so they see immigrants and foreigners who settled as somebody to be interested in. Mm-hmm. And one of the first things with Bratislava, already last year, the mayor of Bratislava had the lunch for some of the foreigners, just sending this symbolic message showing, yes, I see you, and you are a very important part of Bratislava. Bratislava wouldn't look like Bratislava without you. You bring a lot of value. I think those messages were sent out, but now we want to go more into a detail. So the Bratislava administration, they are going to do this metropolitan plan and also a plan on provision of services to communities. And they wanted to set up different working groups with different target groups. And one of the target groups which is defined is actually specifically foreigners, right? So you can take into account that they don't speak Slovak, or maybe they don't speak Slovak that well enough, so you need to think of different languages. Maybe they're from different cultural background, even if we think that it should be understandable. Did we explain ourselves clearly? Did we do policies that is understandable? Do they accept specificities? Or maybe also foreigners bring a lot of foreign knowledge from their own countries. So the city of Bratislava wants to open to that, and on 13th of August they're going to have a first meeting of the working group to just explain the process that they want to do with foreigners, which may lead to even maybe also setting up a platform of foreigners who are interested to bring input to the Bratislava municipality. And they will be asking for some kind of feedback also to what's going on in the city and how things can be done and run in the city. So I think for those who want to be active and who want to engage in that, it's a great opportunity. Together with our partner foundation of Milan Šimečka, we are organizing, and the city of Bratislava, we are organizing this meeting, and it's going to be on 13th of August. But more information will be also provided under this video, where you find the link where you can register if you want to attend. Of course, you can come also without registration, but for us it's better to know who is coming and already with some information provided, so we can prepare ourselves.
Definitely. Yes. So I will share it with pleasure.
When you register, you get information about the place and the precise time this day, where it's and what time is going to take place.
Definitely. Yes. So I will share it for sure in the description. So I already put it in like my notes to share it. So for sure I will.
Thank you, Andrea.
And yes, actually, as the last question, I would like to ask you if you have future plans. Of course, future than more than August, because
maybe also some of foreigners noticed, because we had several people writing to us when maybe 2 weeks ago we put out this advertisement that we're searching for cultural mediators in Bratislava. We still haven't closed this down. Not that I'm calling for more applications, because we received very interesting applications from interviewing people. But we cannot really work with everybody, but we would like to know everybody. So that's why I decided that we will give it an opportunity to meet. As I mentioned, that next week we're going to have Friday at 4:30 in Baštova 5 Open Gallery. We're going to have this meeting. We're also going to invite all of the people who applied for this position. We'll explain what it is. And I think many people were also writing that they are even interested in doing volunteering. So maybe we can together find out the way how all of this activism of the people who wrote to us can be put in place in help to the community or to each other. Because I think that there are many interesting things which can be done. For us, the position of the cultural mediator was to help with the organizing of the events that we organize, to give us outreach to communities, to help us with the newsletter, to see what kind of information there is missing. So have like a first-hand person who help us to bridge us as Slovaks who want to help with the community that we want to help to, but we may not understand and have the first-hand experience. So the cultural mediator should be the one who helps us to bridge, and also to help us bridge with other authorities, such as city administration. So this is something what we would like to do. And of course, not everybody can be a cultural mediator for us, but we would like to maintain the club of friends of foreigners, if they are interested doing in some kind of volunteering work for us. It could help us also to maybe have somebody who would help us to do some better on our communication in English or in other languages that foreigners speak. We do not really want to neglect the community who speaks Russian or Ukrainian. Ukraine is the largest community, or even Serbian. So these will be interesting things for us to see. So far, so it's probably all. We are at the moment, one of the things that we would like to raise capacity for is question of labor law and immigrants and these kinds of area, because we've been receiving many requests from foreigners who would find themselves in Slovakia in not the best position with their employer, where they would be facing that the working conditions would not be as they should be, or they would be in a way, let's say, possibly abused, or even people who would become a victim of trafficking, that they were trafficked to Slovakia, for example, for some kind of laborer, and then they would not be paid, and then they would be deported to their country. So this is some area in which we are trying to raise our capacity in terms of allowing our personnel to be able to engage in helping these people, but also raising our expertise in this area, because we think this is something which is becoming a little bit more problematic with more foreigners coming to Slovakia for employment.
Okay, great. So really very incredible initiative. So thank you very much for sharing this, and a really pleasure to share it to this, to all the my listener, I would say, in the community. So thank you very much, Barbara, for your time.
Thank you, Andrea, for giving me this opportunity.
And of course, I will share your activities, of course, in the description, so you will find everything. So really, thank you very much.
Thank you too. And thank you everybody who was listening.
Thank you.
So, if you are interested to have more information about the initiatives for foreigners proposed by the Human Rights League in Slovakia, you can find their contacts in the description of the episode, plus some links to their initiatives discussed previously, like the working group and the newsletter. Thank you for being part of the Slovakia Chronicle family, and stay safe.